One of my favorite quotes comes from the late affective neuroscientist Jack Panksepp, who said that sound is a special form of touch. This is actually literally true, because sound signals coming from the cochlea travel through the thalamus of the limbic system before reaching the auditory cortex. This means we feel music before we even hear it. Music evolved to be a social emotional signal. Formal gestures in music can resemble the sound of an animal in pain or a person in trouble. Things like a piercing saxophone note or a low cello moan can cause something called emotional contagion, where the sound itself resembles a feeling. These sounds can trigger automatic, reflexive responses. Music-induced emotions are actual physiological reactions and not just a cognitive appraisal of what good music should sound like. This suggests that humans evolved to be musical in the same way that we evolved to be linguistic. But there's a problem with that idea. Not every human experiences emotion from music, despite having a fully functional reward system. Individuals whose brains have reduced functional connectivity between the auditory and reward systems experience musical anhedonia, an absence of pleasurable feelings from music. It affects an estimated 5 to 10% of the general population. Musical anhedonia is not the same as tone deafness, because persons with anhedonia are not impaired in perception. They can memorize and sing melodies just like the average music listener, nor is there anything wrong with their dopaminergic reward system. Persons with musical anhedonia have the typical emotional responses to art, food, money, and other types of pleasurable stimuli, just not to music. Here are the connections affected. These arrows show that our hearing system and reward system are heavily connected. The auditory cortex receives sound and informs the inferior frontal gyrus. This area is along the ventral path, and so it is where judgments about music content are made. It also feeds the insula. That's an important nucleus for self-awareness and other social concerns. So the auditory cortex lets the nucleus accumbens know when some good music is being heard. This tells the caudate nucleus to expect a treat and tells regions in the prefrontal cortex of this pleasure, which can launch daydreaming or mind wandering while listening. All of these arrows represent typical connectivity. In musical anhedonia, the orange arrows show where connectivity is greatly diminished. So this listener can hear the music perfectly well. They just report that it sounds flat or unexciting. For listeners who are sensitive to musical pleasure, music's most exciting moments can generate a chill response, also called goosebumps, hair standing on end, or by its technical name of piloerection. Most people do experience chills to music, although they don't happen that often. Acoustic triggers for the chill response vary across individuals, but here are some general features that cause them. Dynamic changes, like sudden loud or soft moments. Crescendos, or slow builds to a climactic moment. Dissonant musical intervals can cause chills. Unexpected melodic or harmonic changes can also cause chills. Textural changes, such as when new instruments suddenly enter, and perceived emotionality, like when a singer is especially skilled at expressing their feelings. And, last but not least, virtuosic performance skill can cause chills. Most of the research today suggests that gender, age, and musical training do not correlate with the tendency to get chills from music. It helps to be empathetic and, of course, to like music. Persons with musical anhedonia do not get music-evoked chills. There are a few personality measures that have good test-retest reliability. These have found that persons who get chills in response to music tend to rate highly in the trait of openness to new experiences. In the next video, we will walk through the chain of events leading to an emotional response to music.